Okay, so then we'll start here. So under the bank customer relationship, we said it's a contractual relationship and the banker has duties towards the customer and bank has right where you can exercise against the customer. So we'll see what are the preliminary obligation of the bank under the banker's customer relationship. The preliminary obligation of the banker is to receive money and collect bills of the customer. So that is the preliminary obligation or duty under the banker customer relationship. So you see, now when a banker allows a customer to open an account, then we create a contractual relationship under the contract, under the banker customer relationship contract. The customer has a right to operate his account after opening the account. So when you are saying operating the account, what are the activities that he can perform? So he can deposit money and he can withdraw money. So basically, he has a right for that. The customer has a right to deposit money and withdraw the money. So therefore, in the other side of the right of the customer is the obligation of the bank. The obligation is when the customer deposit money or some third party deposit money or credit money to the customer's account, the bank has an obligation to collect that money to that account. When we say the collect money, not only the money, checks, the bills also can be deposited to the account, and we, as a bank, we have an obligation to collect those checks, bills as well as money, right? So that is a preliminary obligation of the banker under the banker customer relationship. Then we'll see the next one. Providing banker's opinion. This is an obligation on the banker where we have not much familiar or we have not much performed this duty. I believe as a banker, when you are performing your duty, you may or performing your work, when you may have not much performed this obligation. Now you see, when I asked from the students, my previous students, what have you ever given a banker's opinion, most of them said yes. But when I asked what was the opinion that you provided, actually what they said they provided certified banker's accounts, or they issued a letter to the embassy or visa officer on instructions of the customer. Likewise, they gave the answers. Actually, that is not banker's opinion. Providing balance confirmation on the request of the customer, or providing account statement to a particular person on the request of the customer, is not the idea or meaning of banker's opinion. Banker's opinion is a different thing. The banker's opinion, as a banker under the banker customer relationship, we have a duty to provide this opinion. Then what is this what is this duty? We'll understand. Now we say we have a customer. We say we are a commercial bank, and we have a customer called A. We say he is a businessman. Between commercial bank and Mr. A, there is a relationship, banker customer relationship. Now Mr. A wants to invest money in another business which is owned by Mr. B. Right, Mr. A and B, they have not engaged in any business. So therefore, Mr. A does not know the actual financial situation or the actual situation of the business of Mr. B. So you know that when we any businessman or any person, when he wants to invest money in another business, so he actually wants to know the actual situation of the other business that he is going to invest. We say now Mr. A want this information basically to get an idea to decide whether it is worth to invest money in B's business. So where can he get this information? So he can get this information from the financial statement audited accounts published by the company, Mr. B's company, if it is a company, and if they have published audited accounts and all. But when it comes to bank, the actual financial status of the business, so that is available, that business financial status or data is available with the banker of Mr. B. We say Mr. B is the customer of HNB. So he has an account, his business has an account in HNB Bank. So HNB has the information or financial information of the bank, of the business of Mr. B. But if Mr. A requests that information from HNB, HNB cannot provide that information, because if they provide that information, that will be a breach of duty of secrecy. And there's no relationship between A and HNB. A is a third party. When HNB and B has a contractual relationship, that is banker customer relationship. Now Mr. A wants to get this information, so he can use this banker customer relationship to get this information from HNB. Even though we say it is information, actually speaking, it is not an information. It's an opinion. This is very important. When we say the banker's opinion, under the banker's opinion, you can provide only an opinion, not information. So you have to be sure about that. You have to be thorough about that. You can't provide account details, information under the banker's opinion. Only thing that you can provide is an opinion. So Mr. A can request from his banker, that is commercial bank, to get an opinion of Mr. B's business, financial status of the business from HNB. So when he requests from commercial bank, the commercial bank will request that opinion from HNB. So then the HNB is bound to provide that opinion to commercial bank. The commercial bank will then give that opinion to the Mr. A, their customer, right? So then through this channel, Mr. A can get this financial opinion and then decide whether it is worth to invest money in this business. So then this is a mechanism. A requests the opinion from his banker, that is commercial bank. Then the commercial bank requests from the other bank, that is HNB. So HNB provides the opinion of their customer to commercial bank, and commercial bank provide that information to, or rather not the information, the opinion to Mr. A, their customer. So HNB just can't directly send the opinion to the third party. That is not the way. It has to come from the proper channel. So, however, remember, providing banker's opinion is not a breach of duty of secrecy. This is very important. And it is a duty of the banker under the banker-customer relationship to obtain an opinion for their customer and also provide an opinion of their customer when the other bank requests. So you may, someday, you may get an opportunity or you may get a chance to provide an opinion. However, if you get a chance or if you have to provide an opinion, banker's opinion, there you have to remember certain principles. Because it's very, very dangerous, I would say, if you provide information under the banker's opinion, then it could be a breach of duty of secrecy. So basically, there are three ways that, or three common the opinions that we use in the banking industry under the banker's opinion. So which covers the bank from breach of duty of secrecy. So what is the first type? The first type of opinion, you see, it says respectable, trustworthy, and considered good for your figures and purpose. We assume that Mr. A is going to invest 50 million rupees in this business. So now, Mr. A wants to know the financial status of Mr. B's business. So he has requested an opinion from his bank, commercial bank. Now the commercial bank has asked the opinion from HNB. HNB is the bank who provides, who generates the opinion, because B's accounts are with a commercial bank. Sorry, with HNB. Now HNB. Now they looked into the transaction, account transaction of Mr. B, and they see he has a very good record. He is a long-standing customer. He has obtained loans and he has paid the loans without default. And also his business turnover is very high. So they know that someone is going to invest money in this business, amount knows 50 million is going to invest. So then the banker has to make a judgment now. So banker, that's why it says that when you are when you are working as a banker, you are providing opinions to the others and also advice, business advisors or financial advisors to the others. So this is one occasion that you provide an opinion. Actually, it is a business opinion or business advice to a third party, not to a customer. So you see that his business is, Mr. B's business is very good and his turnover is high, and you assume or you decide anyone can easily or without any hesitation can invest 50 million rupees in this business. It's a good, since it is a good business. So in a situation like that, you provide an opinion in first category. What is that? Respectable, trustworthy, and considered good for your figure and purpose. Figure is 50 million, purpose is investment. We say it's respectable person because he is not a defaulter and he's doing very, very business. So therefore we say respectable and trustworthy customer. So this is the first type of opinion you can provide of a good customer. You see, no information is provided under this opinion. You have not mentioned the account number, you have not mentioned the value or the money value in the account, nothing. Or you are not talking about the loans he has obtained and the repayment, nothing. Only just give an opinion like this. So, but when Mr. A get an opinion like this from the banker of the other side, so he he gets an idea that the other customer, the other party that he is going to invest money, he has a good financial background. His financial status is good and his business is good. So therefore, based on this, he can decide to invest money. That is number one. Number two type of opinion says respectable, trustworthy, but your figure is larger than we familiar to see. So now you see this customer is a good customer. He has doing business, or he has a long-standing relationship with the bank, and he has obtained loans, he has paid loans, no default. However, his business is a small business. Turnover is not that high. So the purpose that we know, the opinion is asked for a purpose of investment, and the amount is 50 million. So you see, the amount that Mr. A is going to invest in this business is a big amount. We see it's compared to the business turnover, it's a huge amount. So in a situation like that, what is our duty as a banker who is providing a banker's opinion? We can't think that we have to safeguard the interest of our customer, and we have to help him and to get this money. It is not the duty. So remember, under the banker's duty, our duty is to provide the correct opinion. So therefore, then we have to provide an opinion in of a second category. That is, the customer is respectable, trustworthy person, but his business is small, so therefore the investment figure is larger. So therefore we say the figure is larger than we familiar to see. So then the second type of if Mr. A gets a second type of opinion from the banker of the other party, so he knows that even though the customer he has a good the history as a customer of the bank, his business is not generating that much revenue. So therefore, either he can decide not to invest money, or he can decide to invest a lesser amount. So that is the second type of opinion. Third type of opinion says respectable, trustworthy, but has recently opened an account with us, and we cannot speak about the figure. So when we get a request from another bank for an opinion, and we know for what purpose the request comes and what is the amount that they are going to invest, or what kind of transaction that going to happen, so then we say the customer is customer has our customer has recently opened his account. So therefore we can't make any judgment on his financial status. It's too risky to give a good recommendation or bad recommendation. So then if he still is a good customer, and if he has not defaulted any loans, so on, so we can say he's respectable and trustworthy customer, but we have a recently opened account, so therefore we cannot talk about the figures, your figures. So that is the third type of opinion that we can provide, and it's a common opinion that we can provide. Then, what is the liability of the
Excuse me,
bank?
sir.
Yes.
Are those only applicable when they are going on investment, is it?
No, not only that. So it could be a
When they're
transaction.
coming on the FIU or those kind of things are applicable for this?
FIU means
So when they found the financial intermediary, when they send the letters to the banks, if they're sending a letter covering under this opinion,
No,
if they have in
FI,
account.
no, FIU is a unit at the central bank, no. So, right, so they ask certain information from the banks, but that is not opinion, that is not banker's opinion, right? That's a different FIU, is a central, which is in the central bank, which is in the central bank, and they are monitoring the suspicious accounts, suspicious transaction of the customers. That is a different thing, that is coming under a different act actually. This is nothing to do with FIU. This is a transaction between two people or two customers of two different banks. Are you clear?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, it could be investment or it could be some transaction, something like that, right? Or import, export. A banking transaction, whatever, a banking transaction or business transaction between two individuals or companies, two customers or two different banks. Any other questions? Are you clear?
Okay. Yes, sir. So, thank you.
Right. So these are three common type of opinions that we can provide, and there are other types of opinions also that you can see. Now, if it is not a trustworthy person, you can say it is not trustworthy, the customer is not trustworthy, but normally we don't do that. So these three types of opinions we provide. So then what is the obligation or what is the liability of the bank when we are providing an opinion? You see, it's always the obligation is with the bank who provide the opinion. So when we are providing opinion, so that's why we have to say we have to be honest, we have to be accurate, and we have to be, the opinion has to be correct. So then sometimes we provide favorable or too favorable opinions, too favorable to our customer. So sometimes we think, okay, we have to help our customer, so therefore we sometimes we tend to give a good recommendation to our customer. We say we have provided a favorable, too favorable opinion, which is misrepresentation or negligence opinion. So without looking at the account or without going through all the previous transaction, you just provide an opinion. So that is a negligence opinion. Or you see certain drawbacks in his account, but ignoring that, you give a wrong opinion. That is misrepresentation opinion. So which is favorable to our customer. So in a situation like that, what will happen? We say, we take the same example. We say the customer is not a trustworthy customer. He has taken a loan and he has defaulted. Then we have rescheduled the loan. However, now we provide an opinion in the first category. Respectable, trustworthy, considered good for your figures and purpose. So now, actually, this is a misrepresenting favorable opinion. So based on this opinion, what will happen? Mr. A will invest money in B's business. He say, now after investing money, that he lost the money. 50 million he lost because Mr. B's business collapsed. Now, what is the liability on the bank? Third party, that is Mr. A, can ask the damages from the bank, who provides the opinion, that is HNB. So customer of commercial bank, Mr. A, can sue the bank, the commercial bank who provided the opinion for damages. So that is the liability that we, when we are providing an information, rather the opinion. The second liability, so we say we have provided a wrong opinion, which is unfavorable to our customer, right? The commercial bank has provided a wrong opinion about their own customer. So then what will happen? We say the customer, Mr. B, is he's a very good businessman. He has a, we say, 1 billion turnover per year. And he is a long-standing customer and he has taken loans and settled loans and he is very good customer. So, however, the bank provides an opinion, we say, to a second type of opinion. So then what is the situation? So what will happen if Mr. A gets an opinion like this, respectable, trustworthy, but your figure is larger than we familiar to see. So then Mr. A will hesitate to invest money in this business, B's business. So either he will withdraw the investment or he will reduce the investment. So then what happened if Mr. B get to know that the investment didn't come because of the opinion provided by his bank, customer, that Mr. B, can claim damages from his bank, that is commercial bank. So from both sides, the bank who provides an opinion is liable. If you provide a too favorable, misleading or negligence in opinion, third party can claim damages from you. If you have provided a favorable, unfavorable, wrong opinion about your customer, the customer can sue the bank for damages. So therefore, when you are providing opinion, you have to be accurate, you have to be honest, and you have to provide an opinion. You can't provide any information under the banker's opinion. Those four principles that you have to remember when you are providing any banker's opinion. So if you have any questions on banker's opinion, you can ask. Otherwise, I will go to the next one. Third duty of the banker, under the banker customer relationship is duty to honor the customer's check. Now we know under the banker customer relationship, when we allow a customer to open a current account with the bank, the customer has a right to issue checks. That is a unique feature of a current account. So current accounts are operate through checks. So therefore, when he opens a current account, we give him a checkbook. It's a practice developed by the banks at the inception of the banking industry or banking business. The bankers didn't give checkbooks. However, now the practice is every bank, they have printed checkbooks and they give the checkbooks to the customers, and the customers cannot use any other format or any other checks other than the checks or checkbooks provided by the bank. So basically, if you have an account at, we say, Sampad Bank, a current account, you are provided with the Sampad Bank checkbook, you have to issue checks from that Sampad Bank checkbook. You can't issue a check from commercial bank checkbook. That is not possible. So that is a practice developed by bankers, which has now been accepted by court of law. So therefore, it basically a practice developed by banks has now become a law of the bank. It is a part of the banking law. So I said the banker has a duty to honor the customer's check under the banker customer contractual relationship. Now this is an implied duty. It's very important. This is implied duty, because why we say it's implied duty, it is not written in anywhere. So if you take account opening documents or general bank account operating instructions or general terms, banking terms, which you provide to the customers at the time of opening account, this is not covered. Nowhere in this terms and conditions I haven't seen, which says the bank has a duty to honor the checks of the customer. Right? It is not written. However, remember, it is an implied duty cast upon the bank. You can't say that it is not, we have not agreed in writing, so therefore it is not a duty. It is sound because the court, the law says it is an implied duty on the bank. So when we say the bank, it's a duty, an implied duty of the bank, it is subject to certain conditions. In other words, the bank gets this duty subject to the fulfillment of some conditions by the customer. If those conditions are fulfilled by the customer, then we have a duty. Otherwise, it is not a duty. So what are these the conditions that the customer has to fulfill? Number one, if the check is drawn in the proper form. So we have a duty to honor the check if the check is drawn in the proper form. So what does it mean? So you may have observed or you have practiced this, I have seen this, when we present a check, we say cash check, when we present the check to the counter, first thing they do, the teller, they take the check into their hand and then they observe the check and they tick the name, date, figure, these things they checked and they confirm. So what is that? So basically, they are checking the whether the check is written in or drawn in the proper form. So if it is in a proper form, only the bank is obliged to accept it. Or otherwise, you can say that we can't accept the check because it is not completed or it is not in the proper form. We say the check comes without the signature. So the drawer has not placed the signature. He has forgotten to place the signature. Can we accept the check? We know it is issued to the customer, the account holder, and we know that a check leaf is from his checkbook. We can see it is a printed and a check issued by the bank. But still, we can't accept it because it is not a check. It is not a complete proper check. So therefore, we can't accept it. So if it is a proper check, then we have to accept it. So that is number one. Number two, then thereafter, what do you do? When you get a check, when you see the check is in proper form, signature, date, figure, word in figure in words, figure, sorry, amount in words and amount in figures, everything is complete. And the check is, you are satisfied, the check is in proper form. What are you doing next? So in next, you see, you go to the system and you see whether there is sufficient funds available in the account to pay the check. Or if funds are not available, then you see whether you have marked an overdraft limit to the customer. So that is second condition. The check is in proper form. If sufficient funds available in the account, or if you have granted him a overdraft limit. Then we say now the second part is also complete. That means that sufficient funds available in the account. Now the question is, can we pay now? Still, we can't because there are other steps or other conditions to fulfill. Then we have to see whether there is any legal barrier to pay the check. So there can be a court order preventing the bank paying the checks, or there can be a court order to seize the account of the customer, or there can be a order from the Inland Revenue Department, or there can be an order from Customs Department. Likewise, sometimes the customer may have now died after issuing the check. So there can be a lot of barriers, legal barriers to pay the check. So then the third one, you have to check whether there are any legal barriers to pay the check. So we after checking that, if you see there's no legal barrier to pay, then you have an obligation to pay. You can pay now, right? You can pay. When we say you can pay, it is not a duty. Still, it's not a duty. We say the check is presented during the banking hours. Next important thing is the check has to be presented during our banking hours. So you see the different banks or different branches of same bank could have different business hours, right? Some banks, they open from 8 to 3, some banks 9 to 3 or 9 to 2, or some banks from morning to evening, or some banks 24 hours, some banks 24 hours, 7 days and 365 days. Likewise, they have their own banking hours. However, the check has to be presented during the banking hours. We say the bank, that particular branch is open from 9 to 2. So the check has to be presented between 9 and 2. If it is presented during these banking hours, then we have a duty to accept the check. It's an obligation. Then the next one, if the check is presented to the same branch means the same branch where we maintain the account. So if the check is presented during the banking hours, and if it is presented to the same branch, then the bank has a duty to honor the check. So if these five conditions are fulfilled, the bank has a duty to honor the check. So in other words, if these five conditions are fulfilled, whatever the reason, bank cannot dishonor the check. If you dishonor the check, that is a breach of duty of, sorry, breach of banker-customer relationship. So customer can claim damages from the bank if all five conditions are fulfilled. Now you see, now you may have a lot of questions, right? Today, in today's practice, the customers, they don't present the check to the same branch. It is not necessary, right? A customer who has account, who has a current account at Mugegoda branch of, we say, Bank of Ceylon, can present a check to Anuradhapura branch and get money, right? So the question is whether the customer, if customer is presented the check to the Anuradhapura branch of Bank of Ceylon, whether the bank has a duty to honor the check. Whether the bank has a duty to honor the check. So can someone answer to that question? Think that is a question that you get at the exam. Mr. A, who has a... Yes?
Can you honor, sir?
My question is whether the bank has a duty to honor the check.
Yes, sir, can honor, because I have done.
Now, listen the question carefully. This is why sometimes you see at the exams we won't get the full marks. The question is, Mr. A, who has an account at Bank of Ceylon, Mugegoda, has presented the check to Anuradhapura branch. We say it's a cash check and Mr. A wants the money. The question is whether the Bank of Ceylon has a duty to honor the check. First, you have to say yes or no, then explain. Can someone answer? Can someone answer, please? Whether Anuradhapura branch of BOC or BOC has a duty to honor the check, and explain your answer.
Yes, the bank, yes, should honor the check, because in the current context, the unibanking system has been evolved, so the all branches are linked into one core banking system.
Yeah.
So since the bank has a duty to honor the check.
Right. Okay. What's your name?
I'm Alfred.
Yeah, Alpha, now your answer partly correct, right? Why I say it's partly correct, the explanation is correct. The first part is wrong, right? I asked whether the bank has a duty to honor the check. So you see, I said, to become it's a duty, all these five conditions has to be fulfilled. Now you see, now the check has not been presented to the same branch. It has presented to Anuradhapura branch. So therefore, it is not a duty. It is not a duty of the Bank of Ceylon. If it is presented to the Nugegoda branch, definitely it is a duty. There's no doubt. Now, as you said, we have a unibank system. We have a computer system which connect all the branches of the bank. So basically, in one branch can see the accounts details of the other branch customer. So therefore, we interconnected as a one bank, which is called unibank. So the question is, under the unibank system, since we can observe or since we can easily pay the check by checking the account of the other branch's customers, whether it's a duty. Actually, it is not a legal duty under the banker-customer relationship. We call it, it's an extra service that we provide to the customer. So, unibanking system is an extra service that we have provided to the customer. If it is an extra service, customer does not have a right for that. And bank has no duty to provide extra services to the customers. Now we say, now we have check deposit machines. We have cash deposit machines. We have ATM machines, where you can withdraw and you can deposit money. And also you can transfer money. Now those machines are available. All those things are, you see, extra services provided by the bank. For the extra services, that customer cannot claim that he has a right. Now, for example, if I am a customer of, we say, Bank of Ceylon, I can't claim that I have a right to have an ATM machine close to my place. That is not a duty of the bank to provide ATM machines, and also it is not a right of the customer to demand for an ATM machine. It's an extra service. If the bank wants to provide, they can provide the extra service, or they can say that we are not providing extra services. The unibank system or collecting checks of the other branch of the customers, also an extra service that we provide to the customer. So therefore, customers cannot claim that as a duty of the bank. However, the present situation is, unless we provide these extra services like unibanking and ATM machines, we cannot survive in the business. So therefore, it has become a part of banking business. But remember, the law position is different. The law says, if it is an extra service provided by the bank, it is not a duty, but it's the discretion of the bank. For if it is a discretion of the bank, customer cannot claim that as a right. So it is not a right. So that is the answer for that question. Any clarification or any questions that you have from here, you can ask.
Sir, one more question, sir. When we talk about stop payment, on yeah. what ground the customer can stop payment of a check, sir?
He can stop the check as he wish. Basically, he doesn't want to provide any reason to the bank why he has stopped the check. So basically, if I am a customer, I can issue a check today and immediately I can stop, I can give countermand instructions to the bank, and I have no obligation to provide any reason for the stop payment. Clear? Are you okay with the answer? Yes, okay. Any other questions? Okay, so then remember, I have given in this slide in red color, if these five conditions are fulfilled, then the bank has a duty to honor the check. If any one of these conditions is not fulfilled, it is not then a duty. But a bank, if bank has a bank has a discretion, then to pay the check. So you said bank can pay. So bank can pay means you have a discretion. For example, we take the fourth one. If the check is not presented during the banking hours, what will happen? So bank can say, we are not accepting the check, we are returning the check because it is not a duty. But some banks can say, okay, that we will accept. So that is a discretion that bank has used. So and when you are doing that, you are taking a risk also. Now, for example, we say customer has issued a check today. It's a cash check and it has given to a third party. That third party brings the check in the evening after banking hours. Right? We say he comes at 4:30 and we close at 3. And bank manager or banks knows this person, and banks accept the check and paid the check after banking hours. Next day morning, when you open the bank, 9 o'clock in the early in the morning, first person comes to the bank is the customer and that account holder, and he gives instructions to stop the check. Now what is the situation? Now you have already paid. You have paid after the banking hours. You have no duty to pay the check, but you have used your discretion and paid. Payment is valid, but you are running a risk. What is the risk? The customer now has stopped the payment, countermanded the payment. So therefore, customer now can claim damages from the bank. Customer can say, now you are not obliged to pay after, or you are not bound to pay, or you are not duty bound to pay after 3 o'clock. But you have paid, so that is your discretion. Now you are countermanding the check, so pay me the damages. You have paid against my instruction. So therefore, when we are providing or when we are using our discretion and providing services to the customers, sometimes we are running a risk. But when we are in the business, we have to, you know, adjust our practices to provide a good services to the customer. At the same time, remember that we have to safeguard the right of the bank, and also most importantly, rights of ourselves. So therefore, be careful when you are doing those, sometimes we say helps to customers, know the legal background or law principle, then you decide whether it's worth to do that or not. So then that is about the third duty to honor the customer's check. If bank willfully dishonor a check of the customer, can sue the bank for a breach of contract and claim damages. So if customer has fulfilled all five conditions mentioned above, still if the bank has not honored the check, that is a clear breach of contract, bank customer relationship contract. So in a situation like that, the customer can sue the bank. So that is the third duty of the customer. Then we come to the most important duty under the banker customer relationship. This is a very, very famous area, I would say. Every year, every exam paper, there is a question from here. So remember, this year also, definitely there will be a question from this duty of secrecy. Very important. duty of secrecy means, if I say in simple language, duty of secrecy means the banker or bank officers, they should not divulge any information of their customer to a third party without the consent of the customer. The bank officer or banker should not divulge or give any information of their customer to a third party without the consent of the customer. So that is called duty of secrecy. So bank is bound to keep this duty, secrecy of the customer as a duty. So this is not limited only to the account details, but also to all other facts arising out of the banker-customer relationship. That is another thing that we have to remember. There's a misunderstanding among the bankers. They believe they have a wrong understanding, that they think under the duty of secrecy, only the account details are protected. So you say you think that you can't divulge only the account details, other details that you can provide. It is not covered under the duty of secrecy. It is not the case. Remember, the interpretation of duty of secrecy says the banker should not divulge any information of the customer. Any information. When you say any information, it covers account details and as well as other details of the customers also. So what is the scope of this thing then? When we say any information, what is the scope? What are the things covered under any information? Whether can we say that if someone asks, we say there's a customer called Lahiru, right? So someone, a third party asks, there's a account holder in your bank whose name is Lahiru. We want to know whether he is a man or a woman. So then can you divulge that information? He's a man, right? So can you say that there is an account holder, what you said is correct, that Lahiru is our customer. He's a male. Can you provide that information? If you provide that information, whether it amount to a breach of duty of secrecy? Yeah, it could be. So that is, reason is this, the any information that the banker get to know about their customer, of their customer, which fact has arisen out of the banker-customer relationship, is covered under duty of secrecy. So basically, when a customer open an account with a bank, he provide all the information to the banks. So what are the information that available with us of our customers? We know their personal information. We know their name, their date of birth, date of place, everything, because he provides the identity card and his personal address, personal contacts, and family information. Everything is provided with the bank. That is number one. Then about his income information, financials information. So that is also provided. We get to know the customer's information at the time of opening the account, and also when he is operating his account, we see his income information. We have those information with us. Then his social information, so that also available with us. Now, for example, we say we have issued him a credit card. So when you check his credit card, you can see his spending pattern, the places where he has visited, how many times he has gone abroad during the last few months. So likewise, we know his social or what are the clubs that he goes, what are the sports clubs that he takes, he has a membership, all these things available with the bank. So remember, all these information came to the bankers or bank officers not because they have personal relationship or friendship with this customer. So those information came to the hands of the banker as a result of banker customer relationship. So the customer gave this information because he has to provide that information to the bank. So under the KYC or under the whatever. So the information came to the hands of the banker as a as a result of banker customer relationship. So therefore, all those information are covered under the duty of secrecy. So without the consent of the customer, that information that we cannot provide to any third party. So the banker's customer's name, his address, his personal account number, whether he's married or not, right? What is his income, where he works, his credit card information, those things that you can't provide to any third party. So we have a lot of occasions that we have seen the bankers has provided this information because they have a misunderstanding. Certain information, they believe that if you provide that information, it won't be a problem because it is not covered under duty of secrecy. Now, sometimes you know that spouse, husband or wife can call to the bank, call the bank and ask the details of husband or wife's account details, so credit card account details, so balance of accounts likewise. Now the question is whether we can provide that information to the spouse. Spouse is a third party when it comes to banker customer relationship. The banker customer relationship is with the bank and the customer. So customer spouse is a third party. So therefore, even to the spouse, you can't provide that information as a bank. So sometimes these things happen. So therefore, remember, should not divulge any information of the customer to any third party. This is a substantial principle of law of banking. Substantial principle of law means it's a fundamental principle of law. So there's no excuse, no exceptions. So it's covered and it's covered everything, and it's a well established principle of law. This has been recognized in the Banking Act, and the bankers are bound by the act also. So remember, the duty of secrecy, it was there from the beginning of the banking industry. The initial stages, it was not there, but however, later on, when the court has developed a principle where the duty of secrecy, now it's a part of banking business or banking industry. Initially, this duty of secrecy was a part of other professionals like doctors, lawyers, accountants. They had this duty of secrecy. Now, for example, if you take a lawyer, that lawyer gets the information of their customer or the client. Now, we say a murderer goes to a lawyer and he confesses the lawyer and he says, I killed the so-and-so. And the murderer wants the service of the lawyer to protect him in the case. So lawyer knows that information. Lawyer knows whether this person has killed or not, whether he is the killer or not. But he, even the judge won't ask that question from the lawyer, right? Judge won't ask from the lawyer whether your client has killed or not. So lawyer has a duty toward this customer or client. He has to protect the customer's information. He cannot divulge that information. Even police at the investigation can't question the lawyer and ask the lawyer whether this person has committed the crime. So it is the duty of the police to find it, but he can't question the lawyer because they know that lawyer is bound by the duty of secrecy. It's applied to the doctors also, the patient's information. The doctors cannot divulge to a third party without the consent of the patient. So therefore, initial stages, this duty of secrecy was attached to certain professionals. However, later on, by the development of law, by applying this principle of the duty of secrecy in the banking industry by court of law, now it has become a part of banking business. However, when the Banking Act established in Sri Lanka in 1988, this duty of secrecy has been included into the Banking Act. So therefore, it's very, very clear now, it is a part of banking law and it is part of Banking Act also. So as per the section 77 of the Banking Act, these sections that you have to remember when you are answering the questions in exam paper, that you have to write the correct section also. So therefore, remember, section 77 of the Banking Act says every banker or bank officer or bank staff, when they are resuming a work as a banker, they have to sign a document called Declaration of Secrecy. So they have to give a Declaration of Secrecy. They say the Declaration of Secrecy means that the bank staff give a declaration to say that he will not breach the duty of secrecy and he will not divulge any information of their customers to a third party without the consent of the customer. So that is called Declaration of Secrecy, which is coming under Section 77 of the Banking Act. Then, after giving a declaration, or even without giving a declaration, if a customer or if a staff, bank staff, breach the duty of secrecy, if you breach the duty of secrecy, what is the liability? What will happen? Section 79 of Banking Act is applicable there. Section 79. Section 79 says, if you breach duty of secrecy as a banker, as a bank staff, you are committing a crime. It's a criminal offense. It's a criminal offense. So criminal offense means that you can be charged in a criminal court of law. What are the crimes that we know? Murder, rape, likewise, those are the crimes. So duty of breach of duty of secrecy also a crime. So therefore, you can be punished in the criminal courts. Then what is the fine or what is the the punishment that you can get if you breach the duty of secrecy as per section 79 of Banking Act? If you breach the duty of secrecy, the court can impose 1 million fine and also imprisonment for 3 years, that you can put into jail for 3 years. So 1 million fine and 3 years imprisonment is the punishment for the breach of duty of secrecy. So you see now the gravity of this a breach of this duty. It's very important. Sometimes we are very negligent, so we are not that much bother about this thing, but however, it's time to bother about it and also be vigilant. We should not divulge any information. It could be a breach of duty of secrecy. Then we can be punished before criminal court and can be subject to the punishment of fine of 1 million and also can be put in the jail for 3 years. So that is the duty of secrecy. So when we say the duty of secrecy, there is an important case that you have to remember. So basically, if you get a question for the exam to explain what is duty of secrecy, if you write all these things that in this slide, you get we say if it's a 10 mark 10 points that you can get, then you get 5 marks. And if you elaborate the duty of secrecy by using this case, then you get the rest, the other 5 marks. So this case is very important. The case is Tonia versus National Provincial Bank. Tonia versus National Provincial Bank. So to easy to remember, we use the name as Tonia case. So what is this case, Tonia case? In this, is the first, I would say, the turning point of the banker's duty of secrecy, because in this judgment, the court established or court emphasized that the duty of secrecy is a part of banking business. So therefore, the bankers are bound by duty of secrecy. So this is the well famous case. So therefore, it's very important to remember the facts and also the judgment. What happened in this matter? Mr. Tonia, he was a customer of this bank, National Provincial Bank. He had a current account with that bank in a particular branch. His account was overdrawn, and bank manager, they tried to recover, but Mr. Tonia didn't pay, so he was basically defaulter. This Mr. Tonia, he was employed in a company as a salesman. He was worked in a company. This company also had a current account in the same bank and also in the same branch. A coincidence, the bank had both accounts, Mr. Tonia's account and also the company's account where Mr. Tonia worked. And one day the bank received a check. Bank received a check presented by a third party for the payment, for the collection. And the bank observed the check has been issued by the company. And it is in favor of Mr. Tonia. The payee is Mr. Tonia. And what has happened? Mr. Tonia has negotiated the check to this third party. He has endorsed the check and has negotiated to a third party. Now the third party, the bearer, has brought the check to get the money. So he presented the check. Bank not been negotiated to a third party, then Mr. Tonia has to bring the check. If we deposit the check to his account, Mr. Tonia's account, check can get realized, the money will come to the Tonia's account, then bank would have easily recover Mr. Tonia's OD from that money. Now what is the situation? The check has been now negotiated and the money will go to a third party account. So therefore, bank cannot set off that money against the OD of Mr. Tonia. So bank manager got mad and he observed that the third party who brought the money check to the bank, he had an account with this same branch and he was a person who provides gambling services. So now when you put the facts together, what has happened? Mr. Tonia is engaged in gambling and he has lost the money. So then he has given his check to this person, the gambling service provider, and negotiated and given that check to that person. So then that person brought the check for the payment. So then what happened? Mr. The manager got very upset. He was mad. And what he did, he contacted a director of the company and informed about this incident. He said, Mr. Tonia has a current account with us and he has overdrawn the account and he has defaulted the payment. And you have issued a check and he has given this check to so and so. And we are sure that he is engaged in gambling services and so on. And he said, he's not a person with good character. He's a gambler. Likewise, he has informed the company. The MAG manager has informed a director of the company. So Mr. Tonia, he was in contract basis. He worked in this company in a contract basis. So at the end of the contract period, the company didn't extend the contract. They terminated the contract on the basis that Mr. Tonia, is not a person with good character because he is engaged in gambling. So then Mr. Tonia, after losing the job, he just inquired, he investigated how this information went to the company. So then he realized, he got to know that the bank manager is the person who has informed all these things to the company. So then what happened? Mr. Tonia filed action against the bank, asking damages for losing his job and other damages. He asked losing his income. Likewise, he claimed that damages from the bank. So then the matter went to the courts. The court decided, from the bank side, bank argued, the duty of secrecy is not a part of banking. This case, remember, this was decided long time back, right? Not in recent past, very old case on that. So at that time, this duty of secrecy was not established as a part of banking business. So what happened for the bank, from the bank side, their lawyers argued, the duty of secrecy is not a part of banking business or banking practice. So therefore, providing information to a third party is not a breach any duty under the banker-customer relationship. So that was their argument. But from the other side, the customer side, the customer's lawyers, they argued, it has to be a part of the bank, duty of secrecy has to be a part of the banking business because of the nature that they hold the information of the customers. It should be a part of the banking business or banking practices. That was their argument. However, the court decided, and court's opinion they expressed, and they said, they decided the duty of secrecy is a part of banking business. The banker should not divulge any information of the customer without the consent of the customer. In this occasion, the bank manager has divulged the information of the customer, which came to the manager's or banker's knowledge, to the hands of the banker as a result of banker-customer relationship. So therefore, it is a clear breach of duty. Breach of duty of secrecy. So this is a turning point of bankers' duty of secrecy. when it comes to law relating to bankers' duty of secrecy, this case is we are following even today. It has not changed. It's that's why we say it's a fundamental, important, paramount, important case with when it comes to the duty of secrecy. That you have to remember, and also in your answer that you are answering, when you are answering, should be a part of your answer to get the full marks for the question. So that is
excuse me, sir. Yes. When we answer the if we get the kind of question, when we answer these when we answer, do we need to mention all the stories, or we have to inform Tony West National Provisional Bank case?
Good question, right? It depends on the nature of the question, right? Now, for example, if you get a question like this, explain the legal principle established by Tonia versus National Provincial Bank. We say you get a question like that, then you say have to see how many marks you get this for this question. We say you get 20 marks for the question. So then obviously that without explaining the facts of the case, that you can't establish the principle of law that established by this case, judgment. So therefore, in a case like that, if a question like that, you have to write the full the facts of the case. But if you get a question like this, explain the duty of secrecy, considering or giving consideration to the Banking Act and decided cases. Now, if you get a question like that, then you remember, you don't have to write the facts of the Tonia case. So what you have to write only the judgment or the decision of the case. So you, in that case, you can say in Tonia versus National Provincial Bank case, court decided like this, and you have to write the sections of the Banking Act. As per the Banking Act, Section 77, Section 79 says like this. So the duty of secrecy is this. Likewise, it depends on the case or the question that you get. If you get questions to explain the duty of secrecy on Tonia based on Tonia case, then write little facts and then the judgment. Or otherwise, you just mention the name of the case and the decision of the case. That applies to all other questions also, not only to the duty of secrecy. The first thing that you must understand the question correctly, then decide how much of facts that you have to write on the of the case in your answer. Are you clear?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Right. Any other questions? Right. Okay. Then I go to the next slide. Right. So then when we say the duty of secrecy, the duty of secrecy says the banker or bank officer should not divulge any information of the customer to a third party without the consent of the customer. When you looked at this definition, it seems to be it's a duty that under any circumstances that you can't divulge or give information to a third party without the consent of the customer. So, in other words, it's an absolute duty. So absolute duty mean in under any circumstances that you can't do that. It's absolute. So so there's no exception in other words. So if customer won't give the consent under any circumstances, that you can't divulge information. So the question is whether the duty of secrecy, whether it's an absolute duty or there are any exceptions. in other words, are there any way that we can are there any situation that we can divulge information of the customer without the consent of the customer? So when you looked at that, remember, duty of secrecy is not an absolute duty. So that means there are occasions, there are situations that we can and we are obliged to provide information of the customer without his consent. So what are these, so what are those circumstances or situations that we have to divulge information of the customer without his consent? Even he says no, don't divulge, that we have to divulge that information under certain situations. So what are those situations that we are going to discuss now? First one, we can divulge information of the customer with the consent of the customer. That is number one, that we know that if some third party asks information, we can contact the customer and say that so and so is requesting information of your account, whether you are okay, whether you give your consent to provide that information. So if customer says yes, that we can provide that information, we have to get better to get that confirmation in writing. Then you provide the information requested by the party as consent by the customer. So that is number one. Number two, there can be a situation where we are compelled to, as bank, we are compelled to provide that information to the law enforcement authorities, that we are bound to do that. So even though customer is not giving his consent, without his consent, in a situation like that, we have to provide. Now, for example, we say we received a court order from a competent court requesting information, or giving we get an order, court order, requesting to provide information to the police or CID. Likewise, we get orders. If there is a court order, we don't want to get the customer's consent, even we don't want to inform the customer, we have to provide the information as per the court order we have to provide only the information requested or ordered by the courts. We have to provide, and to the person or the body that information is requested. For example, if court asks the information, we have to provide the information to the courts. We can't provide that information to somebody else. So likewise, as per the court order, that we can or we should divulge information. That is one. If there is a request under the customs ordinance under section 9, custom general can issue orders to the banks requesting information, then we have to provide that information to the custom general. That is also we are bound to provide under the law. Then request by bribery commission under the Bribery Commissions Act. So bribery commissioner can ask information from the banks. That is also there. Then request under the provisions of Prevention of Terrorism Act. The police can ask information under the Terrorism Act, Prevention of Terrorism Act, we say PTA. So there are situations, there can be a situation by law, we are compelled to provide that information. So therefore, then without the consent, that we can provide that information. Then when a bank...
Excuse me. So relating to this court order thing, sir. Now yes. Let's say in a bank there's an employee called A. Now he worked as a cashier, right? Yes. So now when he was working as a cashier, he has utilized an account of another person, right? Another person to do some fraudulent activities. And yes. Then for that reason, anyway, his services are terminated. Now, mm-hmm. After the termination of his services, now he will go and challenge his termination in labor court, LT. Yes. Right? now to prove his in LT, to prove his misconduct, anyway, we have to show the court that the statement, account statement of that
Correct.
Particular customer.
Yes.
So in such a situation, so how do we deal with that, sir? Because now this is another person's account, but that statement has to be provided in court.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. The question is whether if you provide that, if you get a statement of the account and produce that in the court, will it be a breach of duty of secrecy?
Yes,
sir. Right. Yeah. No, it is not so. So what you have to do is you have to get a court order to provide that information to courts. If you provide that information in the case into the courts, that won't be a breach of duty of secrecy.
Then we have to make an application saying that we need a court order to produce this account statement. Without that, we can't do that.
We can produce to courts. That is, when we have to inform the courts that we are producing this document for the purpose of proving our case. That is covered. But the problem is, we can't give this information to any other third party.
Yeah, okay.
So. Right? If the court procedure, yes, we can provide. So, for example, we say now we will take a situation like this, right? We say that I have a dispute with another person who is a business partner, right? So I have given him some money. He has deposited that money to his account, but he is now disputing. He says, I never received money. So how can I prove that I gave the money? Because to prove that, I have to bring his account statements to the courts, right? So then what I will do, I will get a court order to the bank. So the bank then has to produce that court, the account statement to the courts. So the bank will bring the documents or the statements, and then thereafter it will be in the case record. So anyone can go through the case record and they can get the information, but the bank will not liable for breach of duty of secrecy. Likewise, when you are proving your case, obviously that you have to provide or you have to bring the account statement of the third party, the account holder, to the courts. So you should know what are the transactions that you have to bring forward. So those information without bringing to courts, that you can't prove the case. So therefore, when in the litigation process, if you make any document or if you produce any document, that is not a breach of duty of secrecy. And also, in the litigation process, if you make any statement regarding another person, so that won't be a defamation actually, because you can't use as a defamation also. So you are protected if you use that particular document or account statement or information only for the litigation purpose. So if you have not used that only for that purpose, if you have published that, then it will be a problem. For example, sometimes we see people go to courts and then when they come out, the media people are there and they divulge information to the media also. Sometimes they come and say, so and so is maintaining 20 accounts in that bank and this bank and likewise. So that is a breach of duty of secrecy if it is done by a bank. So therefore, remember to produce the information only to the litigation only for the litigation purpose to the courts. Then you are protected.
Yeah, then in such case, we don't need to get court order, but in the litigation process, we can produce documents as
exactly.
other documents.
Yes, okay. Exactly. You can do that. And right. not only that, internal audit reports, all these things that you can produce to courts in the process of litigation.
Right, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very
All
much.
Right. Any other questions?
Yes, sir.
If a OIC of a police station called and asked about the customer, can we provide the information to them?
Can you give me an answer to that question looking at this categories in under what category the OIC comes? Easier, it is not a court order, so therefore it is not covering under that. And it is not a request or order under the customs ordinance. It is not a order by the bribery commission. Then the only situation is the police can ask information is a request under the Prevention of Terrorism Act. So he can't basically call and ask, and we should not divulge information. That is not proper, and we can't, because it is breach of duty of secrecy. The police can ask information under the Prevention of Terrorism Ordinance. Any senior superintendent of police can request make a request under the Prevention of Terrorism Act. So they have to come under the particular act. They have to say that we are requesting this information from the bank under the Prevention of Terrorism Act, because we are investigating on this person because he is a suspect of terrorism. So in that case, that we can provide information to the police. Otherwise, no any other circumstances that police can request information from the bank, not verbally, not in writing.
Excuse me, sir. I yes. also received a
One can speak. Yes.
If FIU or Inland Revenue Department officer called and ask about the customer.
FIU Central Bank, of course, we are duty bound to inform. That we are going to discuss next in our next slide, right? So that is covered. FIU or Central Bank. And Inland Revenue Department, yes, they are under the Inland Revenue Department Act. They can issue orders to the bank. So therefore, it is also possible. Now remember, I have given here four examples. These are not the only examples that I can give. There are other occasions that the relevant authorities can request information under the law. So what you have to do is, if you get a order or request under a particular law, so you get legal advice, then the legal team or legal department or lawyer will go through the particular act and will see whether they have the authority to ask that information from the bank, and whether the bank is bound to give that information to that particular authority under the particular act. Or if divulge any information without getting the legal opinion. That's my advice. Okay.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Any other questions?
Yes, sir. I have received the same kind of calls. I have received the document from the CID. From CID unit.
CID or Code Bureau. Yes. Police,
they send letters and over. So the person said, if you have any details, call and inform us. So in that case, so they have given a particular contact person name and all the things.
Yes.
Can we provide, sir, in that case, if you have details under that NIC number? Can you you can call and inform us?
The short answer is no, you can't. But you see those letters, if you read those letters, those are not actually orders. They say basically we are carrying out an investigation on this particular person. If you have any information, we appreciate if you provide that information. Oba me sambandhen sahayogaya dakwanne nam krutagnya vemi. Those are the words that they use. right? They don't say, if you don't do this, this is a violation of law, because they know that is the bank is not bound to do that. So basically, the police cannot issue a such letter. So what they do is, so basically, they write and see whether they can get the information from the bank. So otherwise, what will they do? They go to courts and they get a court order to the bank, and then we have to provide. So basically, the answer is, for those letters, we can't provide that information, but you have to tackle the police in that manner. Otherwise, you know the police know. So you have to very politely say that as per the Banking Act, the provisions of the Banking Act, we cannot divulge any information to you officially. So therefore, please bring a court order, then we will provide all the information. Basically, they want to know whether this person has an account with you or not. So then thereafter, if you say yes, they have an account, then they go to courts and take a court order and bring, then you have to provide the information. Normally what they do is they write to all the banks, giving an identity card number and ask whether you have any account of with you under this identity card. If you say yes, then they go to courts and get a court order. Or sometimes if you say yes, then they send another letter and ask more information. So we have to be very careful. The request letters from the police is not a proper court order or proper order. The police cannot get that information from the bank in that manner. They have to get a court order and provide that information. But if you ask to come to the CID and give a statement, that is different. Then you have to go there and you have to make a statement. And the statement you can mention, you have to answer to the questions. Then thereafter, after making the statement, they can get a court order from courts and produce and to you to get the documents and other information. So that is the answer for that. Any other questions?
Yes, brother, there's a small clarification.
Yes.
Let's say if I'm getting a call from the bribery commission department, and
yes,
they're asking about information of a customer. So
yeah.
Based on that phone call, can I
know
the information, or
no, it has to be a order. It has to be a written order from the bribery commission. And when you get a call from the bribery commission, anyone can call and say that we are calling from the bribery commission. And only the bribery commissioner has the authority to issue an order. So just a clerk or a clerical staff at the bribery commission can't give a call to a bank and get this information. It is wrong, and we should not divulge information. You may basically politely say that you need a written order from the bribery commission to provide that information as per our Banking Act. So therefore, we are not in a position to provide that information. So basically, you can't. Okay, so then I'll go to the next one. The next situation is when the banker owes a duty to disclose to the public. This is another important point that we have to remember. Banker owes a duty to disclose the information of the of the customer to the public. It's very, very tricky point. Now you see, these I have given here four situations where the banker can divulge information of the customer to a third party without the consent under the common banking law. Under the common banking law, because I remember this is under the common banking law, because next we are going to discuss under the Banking Act what are the provisions available to disclose the duty of secrecy. So this is an example question again, under what circumstances the banker can divulge information under common law and under Banking Act. So this is four occasions that we can divulge information under the common banking law. The third one is when the banker owes a duty to disclose to the public. So at what situation or what condition the banker owes a duty to disclose to the public? So basically, it is not to a particular person. You are bound to inform the details of the customer to the general public. Now, for example, we take a situation like this. We say, we say Sakpiti, right? There's a person called Sakpiti Rana Singha. He has misappropriated the funds of the public. So public, basically, he has taken money or deposit from the public, and he has misused the funds, and then the depositors, the general public, they had issues with him, and they went to courts and filed action against this person, and still they are struggling to get their money. So we say this person, he has an account with us. He is maintaining account with us, and there's a huge money in this account which has not disclosed to the courts, and there's no court order or anything, and no one has noticed the account is there's an account of this person with us. So in a situation like this, when we know that there is a public tension going on, the depositors are trying to get the money of this person, so we as a bank has a duty to disclose this fact to the public. So basically, we don't want to get the consent of the customer. The customer won't give consent. So as under this duty to the public as a bank, we can divulge the information that we are maintaining account of this person to the general public. When we say general public, we don't go to the public and we don't say that we have account and all. So what we do is we inform the law enforcement authority about the account. Then the law enforcement authority will take that to the appropriate courthouse or tribunal. For example, if we have an account like this, first thing that we have to do is we have to inform the central bank unit. So then if police is investigating, so voluntarily we can inform the police about the account in a situation like this. So we should not hide information in a situation like that, because we have a duty towards the public. That is number three. Number four, when the disclosure is required in the interest of the bank. This is another important point, again, under the common banking law. Disclosure is required in the interest of the bank. What does it mean? Now, I will take another example and explain, then you will understand easily. We say there is a... there is a drug dealer who has captured by the police and now in jail, and the police is now the court has ordered to seize the assets of this person. There is an order, court order, to seize the assets of this person. So he has, now the court has identified, the law enforcement authorities has identified certain assets, and those assets are now seized, including certain bank accounts in several banks. And we say, now we also have an account of this person, and which has not noticed to the police or the law enforcement authorities, and there's no court order to seize the account. Now we have no obligation because there's no court order. However, now what will happen in one day if court get to know that we are holding an account and we have not informed that to courts, then the bank will be in trouble. So for the interest of the bank, in a situation like this, we can inform the relevant authorities and disclose the information to that relevant authority without the consent of the customer. So you see, number three and number four are basically, it's our judgment. We have to decide whether we have to divulge the information under these situations. So these are the four situations or four circumstances that the banker has to divulge information under the common banking law. So that is about the providing information without the consent of the customer. Then we'll go to the other one. There are other situations, there are some situations or where circumstances mentioned in the Banking Act also, where the bank can divulge information without the consent of the customer, which is not then a breach of duty of secrecy. Section 77 of the Banking Act is relevant to this. Now, the section you have to remember, and the circumstances mentioned in the act under this section also that you have to remember. So the Declaration of Secrecy says the director, manager, officer, employee of the bank should observe strict secrecy in respect of the transaction of the bank. So as I told you before, Section 77 says that the banker has to sign a declaration of secrecy. So then he should not divulge information as per this Section 77, except there is an exceptional clause. What is the exception? When required to do so by court of law. So Section 77 of the Banking Act says, if there is a court order, that bank has to provide that information. That is number one. By the person to whom such matter relates, that means if that information is related to the customer, then you don't want to get the confirmation or in consent from the customer, you can inform the customer. So that is number two. Sorry, the other part of number one. Then number two, in the performance of his duties as a banker. This is very important. Number two, you see now, when you compare this one, this is Section 77 of the Banking Act with this, which is the common law situation, that some of these are similar. Now, for example, customer to customer, we can divulge information. That is in the both Section 77 and also in under the common banking law. Then court law, if there is a court of law order, we can divulge information. That is in the common law banking common banking law and as well as in Section 77 of the Banking Act. Now these two, number three and four, you can see it is not in the the Banking Act. It is not in the Banking Act. However, instead of that, we have a different occasion or scenario that we can divulge information. That is in the performance of his duties. When you are performing your duty as a banker, if you are duty bound, this is very important. When you are performing a duty as a banker and when you are duty bound to inform or divulge that information, if you divulge that information, then you are covered. What are the things that you have to see? When you are performing a duty and as a part of that duty, if you are bound to provide that information, then if you provide that information without the consent of the customer, it is not a breach of duty of secrecy. Now, What are the occasions or what are the examples that we provide information as a part of our duty without the consent of the customer? Now, a lot of people ask about the FIU, Financial Investigation Unit, Central Bank. So that is a part of our duty. We are supervised by the central bank. When central bank is request, we are bound to provide this information to the central bank. So therefore, the customer can't claim or customer can't blame the bank if we provide the information to the central bank. Customer can't say that you are duty bound under the Banking Act. So therefore, you can't provide that information to the central bank. Then you can say, no, Section 77, the exception clause says, as a duty that if we are bound to provide that information, then we can provide. So that is one example. Now, what about the minister, relevant minister or the government, if they ask information, finance minister or the president or prime minister's office, they ask a certain information of a customer from the bank. My question is, under Section 77 of the Banking Act, if you are a banker, if you get a letter from the president of the country requesting some information of account holder, are you duty bound to provide that information? Can someone answer to that question? This is an exam question. Can someone answer, please? Doesn't matter whether your answer is correct or wrong. So we go to discuss the question. The question is the president. Forget about the president. We say the minister, finance minister, request certain information. We say finance minister asks, who are the people, who are the borrowers who has obtained loans from your banks last 5 years? They ask a list, the list of names.
Can't.
Right, you say can't. Okay, anyone say can? So when you say can't, that means that under Section 77, you are not duty bound to provide that information to the minister, right? If it is the president, what about the president? What is the answer?
You can.
Huh?
You can.
Can.
Okay. No, sir.
No. Okay. Now we have different answers. Some says can, some says can't. Okay. A gentleman said can. Can you please explain your answer? Why you say you can? Can you explain? Okay. Someone said no, can't. Can you explain the answer? Why you say you can't?
Because banks are now financial institution governed by the Central Bank of Sri Lanka.
Right.
So according to that regulations, we are not able to provide the details, even the president.
Yeah. Okay. So the Section 77. Yes.
The person whom such matter related, we can issue that to them.
You mean to the president?
If a president related to that matter, can we issue the information?
So you are referring to Section 77, Exception 1. Under that, by the person to whom such matter relates. So
yes.
Okay. So it means if customer requests that we can give the information. So if president asks, about the information of his account, of course, we can provide, right? So under that, you can't do. So if it has to be under number two, in the performance of the duties. The question is, when you are performing duties as a banker, if the finance minister or president request information, whether you are duty bound to provide that information. Now we have two answers. One, some people says yes, some people says no. So answer is this, right? If you are a private bank, then you are not bound to provide that information because the minister or the president is not the relevant authority of the bank. So it is only the central bank. So if they want, for example, if minister or the prime minister or the president, if they want certain information, what they have to do is they have to request that information from the central bank. Then central bank will write to you. Then you are bound to provide that information to the central bank. Then central bank, if they want, they can give that information to the relevant government authority. The government authority is not a relevant authority to the private bank. So therefore, we can't directly give information to the minister, prime minister or the president under Section 77 of the Banking Act. So that is about the private bank. What about the government bank? So if you are working in a government bank, then the situation is different. So if you are working in a government bank, the minister who is in charge of banks, I think now it is the finance minister. So he is the government authority who has the control over the banks. So therefore, when the authority requests, the bankers in government banks, they are bound to provide that information. So therefore, the government bank officers, they are bound to provide that information to the relevant authority. The relevant authority is the minister who has the protocol of the subject matter. So the president or the prime minister can't request that information. So what they have to do is they have to ask from the relevant minister, then the minister can get that information and provide to the government. So that is the answer for that. So that is number regarding number two. Then number three, in order to comply with this, yes. Yes.
Excuse me. Now let's say now it's a financial institution, right? In that institution, the major shareholder is another state-owned bank. Let's say it's about 75% or 70%, right? So in yes. such a situation, sir, now they don't directly come under the that category, state-owned category. So in such a situation, sir, what is the
scenario? Okay.
Scenario, yes.
Yes. Okay. If it is not a government bank, it's very clear we can't divulge information to the government authority. Only the authority that we can provide is the central bank. Right? If it is a state bank, then it's different. We can provide to the government authority. If the major shareholder is the government, if the company still it is a private company or private entity, then we cannot provide that information to the government. We have to provide that information to the relevant authority, that is the central bank. Clear? Are you okay with that?
Thank you, sir.
Yes.
Sir, is there any special provision for that purpose? That means the finance minister requests someone's information. The government banks bound to
it's like this. Now, central bank, central bank, now this is coming under section 77 of the Banking Act, no? 77 of the Banking Act, exception number 2 says, when you are performing a duty as a banker, if you have to provide that information to a relevant authority, and if you provide that information to that particular relevant authority, that is not a breach of duty of secrecy. Now, if you are a staff or a banker who works in a government bank, then what is the situation? The government bank is coming under the finance minister. He is the authority, right? Like central bank in the private banks, right? So the finance minister has the authority to get the information from the banks. He is given the authority. So under his authority, if he requests certain information from the bank, as the staff of the bank, that we are duty bound to provide that information to the minister. So he doesn't want to come under any act or any enactment. So by the constitution, he is authorized to request that information. So we are bound to provide that information to the relevant authority under section 77, exception 2 of the Banking Act. So that's how it works. Clear?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Right. Okay. So then the third one is, in order to comply with any of the provisions of the Banking Act or any other law, that is the exception number 3, if you provide information to a third party to comply with the Banking Act or any other law in the country, then that is also covered under this exception. So therefore, there are 3 exceptions in the Banking Act, section 77, where you can divulge information, right? So there, remember these 2 that you have to remember thoroughly. That is the common law provisions that we can divulge information, and the Banking Act section 77 provisions that we can divulge information without the customer's consent. These are 2 different occasions and under 2 different laws. That also you have to remember. This is under common law, common banking law, and this is under the statutory law, that is Banking Act. So you have to basically remember these 2, and also you should be able to compare these 2. There are 4 circumstances here, and there are 3 circumstances here that you can divulge information. You have to compare, you should be able to compare and criticize these 2 occasions, under 2 laws, that is common banking law and Banking Act. So that is about duty of secrecy. Do you have any other lecture after this?
Yes, sir.
You have at 3:15, is that correct?
Yeah, accounts class 3:30.
Okay, so now then it is 3:10. We'll stop at this point. The other thing is the institution is planning to have extra lectures and finish soon the program. So therefore, during next week, if we organize lectures in the evening, say after 6, will you be able to join?
After 7 would be fine, sir.
After seven. Okay, so right, okay. So then coming Wednesday, next Wednesday, we will have a session at 7 o'clock. That will be confirmed by the institution to you. So tentatively we'll say Wednesday 7 o'clock we will continue with our lesson. Okay, so then thank you very much for the participation today. We'll continue from here. Yes.
I have a small doubt, sir. I'm sorry. Yes. When we provide opinion, do we need to inform the customer? So we have received this kind of request from the commercial bank regarding this kind of things.
Not necessary. Not necessary. Okay, you don't want to get the consent of the customer when you are yes.
Another thing,
sir. Duty. It is a duty that you.
Okay. Another thing, sir. So we usually check the accounts. That's if goes to more than 100,000 transaction regular base. So do we have to inform the FIU? That also coming under section 2 in the performance of duties.
Yeah, section 77, exception 2.
Okay, sir. Thank you very much.